So welcome everyone to OWL, How Do I Do Mid-Year Strategic Planning? This is the third or fourth installment of our Now How series in the midst of the pandemic. Each has been on a little bit of a different topic. And joining me again today are our speakers, hosts, we're sort of dual hosts in all of this, our president and CEO here at Better Business Bureau of Central Oklahoma, Kitt Letcher. Say hello this morning.
Hi, good morning, or good afternoon.
Whenever someone's watching this live. And our good friend Dan Shuart with Personifi Solutions. You can say hello.
Hello.
I'm so glad to be chatting with you both again today. So we'll just dig right in. We, you know, our goals for today, for those of you that may not have already seen one of our Now How series webinars, our goals are really to help you all come up with some facts, tips, resources, ideas on how to continue navigating in the pandemic. So, of course, now we have this pandemic coupled with mid-year strategic planning, coupled with, Kitt, you said it best in the Facebook promo, I feel, for this event, that all of our goals have completely flown the coop with you. Here we are. I think most everybody feels that way. And so, you know, today we're going to kind of treat this as a group interview. So those of you that are dialed in live, feel free to utilize our chat feature. I'm Alison Abbott, Vice President of Communications with Better Business Bureau, and I'll be more facilitating today. So, Kitt and Dan, let's start in kind of how we decided we wanted to structure the conversation today. As things are doing mid-year strategic planning, let's think of the concept of outsourcing, automating, and eliminating. And we had initially said, you know, how do we start and even discern priorities in the landscape? So let's start there. Okay?
Yeah. So I'll kick it off. You know, disruption can be a good thing, and we're definitely in a disruptive situation right now. So, you know, it's a good way to leverage that disruptive time that we're in and really look at what's working, right? What did you have to disrupt? Obviously, working from home is a big issue. So looking at that and going, what works out of that? What we're doing right now, what's working, and then what isn't? And a lot of times, too, when you look at that, what's the most disruptive part of my business, that can dictate where your priority is, right? So that might be the thing you really look at. We needed people to work from home, and they couldn't because this process was not automated. That's a great place to start and go, can we automate that? Do we need that paper folder, right? Do people need to physically sign that document? Those are all things you can use to get started in looking at what your plan is moving forward based on the disruption you're experiencing today.
Yeah. Dan, and I'm glad you brought up the paper document, and something that we've talked about before is, like, for us, I have all of our HR files. So if anything happens, they're all in paper form.
Yeah.
And while that has served us well in the current landscape, it's not really very helpful. Obviously, I'm not going to lug people's files around the town and to my home, and that would not be a good practice. So we are really looking at how do we implement new software, new policies, practices, so that we can eliminate all of that paperwork, but so make it accessible to the individuals who need it, whether it's an HR person or an accounting person, and continue to keep the confidentiality of those files, because that's a huge part of it, too. We want to make sure it's safe and secure. You know, we did a building renovation in 2015, and we had every single business that's accredited with CVB and has ever been accredited with CVB had a paper file. And so we had these huge filing cabinets, like the medical ones that you see that are floor to ceiling, and they've, I mean, just short of like the rolling, because yeah, they covered probably 30 feet of our hallway, and it had all of those files, and it was just wild because what do we do with them? And then it was like, do we move them? When we had to move out of the building to do the renovation, we had to come up with a solution. So we ended up hiring an intern, and she scanned all of those documents in, and it took her an entire summer. And it was a great way of using very inexpensive labor. And somebody who could do the work, because there wasn't a lot of technical know-how, but you did need to know, like, how to use a computer and how to use a copier scanner and how to correctly label things. And so I love what you're talking about with the disruption and how that chaos then shows us ways that we can necessitate change and make them change for the better. because we are doing that right now with all of our HR files.
Yeah, yeah. Because I remember you saying you had to come in, right?
That's what absolutely.
Get that data.
Right? Mm-hmm.
And that data agility should be part of your strategic planning, right?
Yeah.
So you can boil this up. You don't have to think, okay, work from home, pandemic, right? That can just be the launch, right? That's the way to get your mind working towards it. But then you can start to think of, you know, I just want to be more digitally agile. I want to, our company to be a, like what they call a digital halo, right? I want to be a leadership role in our market and how we do this, right?
Mm-hmm.
And it's an opportunity to differentiate yourself and set you yourself ahead of everybody else. But it gets those wheels turning, right, on how you're going to plan short and long term.
Well, and the other thing that I really appreciate about it is it gives everybody on your team an opportunity to participate in that process. Because people bring up different struggles or gaps or roadblocks that they're having, which may or may not be the same ones that I'm having. So it really, you know, we get kind of a 360 view of every problem, which I love because it's not so one-sided. And I love that then people can contribute to the problem solving. So I feel like, you know, part of the solution, I had just a piece of this, so it helps them continue to want to be involved and then not be so afraid of the change.
Yeah, yeah. And it's a little easier for smaller organizations because they have, you know, they can get everything together. But for large organizations, that has to be a more planned and concerted effort to do that, to get people's feedback and get people involved in the conversation. But you can organize around that, and that's a great idea. A lot of times it's top down, right? The CEO or whatever thinks, hey, we need to do this, and just tries to sure force of will get it to happen instead of getting, you know, people together from every level of the organization. In fact, reach out to vendors, your partners.
Yeah.
Sometimes you have that right relationship, your competition, right? What are they doing?
Mm-hmm.
What are they after? What are they trying to look at right now moving forward? You know, what are areas that they're improving in? So you really got to widen that circle in your strategic planning, not make it such a, like a one person or even small, you know, group, right?
Yeah.
And expand that out. So, yeah, I'm totally with you.
Yeah. Well, and like that you brought up the idea of talking to your vendors, because that's how we were able to implement a new, like, kind of refresh on our strategic planning that we did this last year. So we have a strategic plan that we've had for the past, like, 3 years, and it was time to update it and get it ready for kind of the new season that we're in. And pre-pandemic, we were going to do this anyway. The pandemic kind of forced us into a little bit of different light, but I had reached out to somebody that I wanted her to be a guest on a webinar series that we were doing. And so in that conversation, she brought up something about doing strategic planning using the SOAR model. And that's not something I've ever used. I'm used to SWOT, where it's strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats. And she said, no, SOAR is really neat because it's looking at the positives of it. And it stands for, I wrote it down because I wanted to remember it, strengths, opportunity, aspirations, and results. And I love that because it's just a really different take on things that we are used to doing and taking that positive spin and not worrying about competition, but worrying about, like, here's where we're going. And right now is such a good time for us to have that mindset because everything's turned upside down. And so we regrouped all of our goals using it.
Mm-hmm. That's great. And there are a lot of tools you can use for planning. That's the hybrid of SWOT, the old SWOT stream. Weaknesses, opportunities, and threats, which I thought was pretty negative, right?
Yeah.
In planning, right? So I never really liked that. So there are a lot of ways to do that. With my group, we do a digital roadmap, right? So we're more on the digital side of things, but we'd like to do help our customers build this digital right avenue. Where are they going digitally, right? What's going to set them apart? Where do they want to head? Because you need that strategic plan. So a lot of times we have one foot on the business side, one foot on the technology side, because obviously they're tightly integrated. But having a roadmap as part of your plan, strategic plan moving forward, I think now more than ever is critical. Because you have to go in and change it now, right, with the pandemic.
Right.
You got a baseline. You got something to start work with and move stuff around and figure out what you need to do. So, yeah, really critical.
Yeah, absolutely. And Dan, when you say digital roadmap, clarify for the audience a little bit, because in today's world, when
some of us here digital, we think cell phones. Some of us here digital, like me as a marketer, and think marketing. You're talking about more IT-type digital, right? And so let's have you clarify that.
Well, yeah. No, you're right, Alison. Initially, yeah. So digital just means your digital footprint, whatever that is. So that's why technology, they think as a, like, my desktop at work or a file server, right, that's technology, a router or something like that. Digital tends to be, mean more on the touch points between business and your digital platform. Right?
Mm.
So when I say digital, that tries to expand out just technology into what your digital footprint is. On our roadmap, we start with the destination. So where you want to go, is it, you know, a better footprint on your e-commerce side, you know, or is it better, you know, AI chatbot related to reduce the call center costs? And whatever that is, figure out what that destination is and what those, more importantly, even the business goals are. So we want to increase revenue by doing better digital marketing. And then we fill in, okay, what has to happen to get you to that destination? From a digital side. But it always includes business, right? You shouldn't and you can't separate the two. I mean, it's all one thing.
Absolutely. Thank you for unpacking that a little bit. And I want to encourage you guys to talk a little bit about some of the tools that the three of us have been kind of chatting about that people might look into as they assess what they may eliminate, outsource, or automate. So things like the chat box feature. Dan, you had a really great example that you shared with Kitt and I, as well as Kitt in our office. We're looking at virtual assistants. So let's share a thought with the audience about, well, those two things.
Yeah, Kitt, you want to talk about your virtual assistant? I thought that
would be. And so, virtual assistant was an idea that was introduced to me, I don't know, probably 5 to 7 years ago. And because we have a receptionist at BBB, which is a really necessary position because we have people who come in, who want to talk to somebody, we need somebody to always answer the phone. She does a multitude of things around their office, which are really significant in the, how everything works. But one of the areas where we get tripped up every once in a while is having somebody always at the ready to answer the phone, because she could be talking to somebody and then the phone rolls over and the next person may not be at their desk. So then there's that lack of continuity with communication. And so one of the things that came up, and I would say just resurfaced, because it just keeps like pumping up to the top, is having a virtual assistant or even a call in line. Like you see in a dental office or a doctor's office where they say, I take the messages and I make sure they call you back. Having something like that may be a good option for us because we don't always need somebody like physically to be there to answer the phone because we're all voice over IP. You know, it's all internet based now. And so it makes that accessibility really nice, but it would be great to have somebody who's dedicated to answering the phone. And so the in-person person can really do more roles and responsibilities and duties and things that make their job more successful. So we've been kind of kicking that around and what that looks like, not to replace anybody, but to really enhance what they're able to do.
And that's a great example of looking at that strategically, right? So we're talking about strategic mid-year planning, and you see a business issue. It's started to exemplify now because of the situation we're in, and you look at a way to automate that. I mean, it's pretty straightforward, but the thought process is what's important.
Mm-hmm.
It's not digital assistance. It's freeing up. You had a couple things, right? You wanted to free up that person to do more knowledge level working, right? You wanted to have, not have to rely on that single point of contact, right? So those are all the business challenges you're facing trying to solve. And so that's automating that or making that better or better interaction with your customer or better customer experience should be the destination you're after. Now, how do you get there digitally?
Right.
Digital assistant is a great way to do it. So you really laid out the right kind of thinking for doing that. Another thing we talked about, just talked about digital capability a little bit, is AI-based chatbots.
Mm-hmm.
So that's really growing. And now I worked, had the opportunity to work on OU's one for their admissions center. And the one thing I liked about that chatbot is that a person can interface at any point. They can be in front of the chatbot, they can be behind it, they can monitoring, they can chat along with the AI chatbot. And then we found out that students, incoming students, couldn't tell the difference between the AI chatbot and when somebody interjected with the chatbot message to a live person. And that rate of 45% of their answering phones, because 80% of the questions are all the same.
Right.
Right? So they take them call after call to answer the same question over and over again.
Mm-hmm.
And then the AI chatbot could actually grab videos, and AI did this, grab the right video if they needed to see a video that would help them out. It would actually insert the video into the chatbot window.
Mm-hmm.
So it's pretty advanced. There's a lot you can do to really cut costs, make customer experience better, right? Add new services and capabilities. It's all there. But you need to think like you're thinking in your strategic planning on what business issues are critical that you need to solve.
Right. You know, and that's an interesting one. We have a chat feature amongst BBBs. And so on our intranet, and so each BBB is autonomous. So we operate together in that we're all kind of partners. But we how we run each BBB office is dependent upon the leadership at that office and the board of directors at that particular office. So we all have our own style and personalities. But the thing we have is an intranet, and so there's a live chat feature on our intranet where we can ping an expert in a certain area and say, hey, like I'm answering this complaint and I have this quick question, how do you think you would answer this? Or we're having a problem running this process through our review policy, or just it could be anything, but it's broken up into different segments so that on the other side of it is an actual expert in that field because they have years of experience or training or whatever it is, and they are accessible to you. And so watching that evolve over the years just internally for BBBs has been a huge success. And making it so that we can work more remotely and the expertise of our team. So, well, a lot of times what we'll see is I'll have a good relationship with another CEO and they'll call and say, hey, do you know anything about this? I'm like, no, I don't do that, but I know somebody who does, and then I'm passing them down the line to somebody in our team who's an expert in that area. And so this just circumvents all of that. So you can go to that expert. It's a great way to like resources. For something that is so internally focused.
Yeah, and I hate when I sound like a therapist. So, but that's the right way to break it down. And a lot of times, what you want to do to choose a plan is just that business goal, what you want to achieve. But don't worry about breaking it down, right? Because there's that discovery process that you want to go through,
mm-hmm.
like you were just talking about. You know, you have this one thing that you'd like to do chat, you know, over our internet, but then through the discovery, find out all these other things that you can do. But
right.
You don't need that in a strategic plan, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I've seen strategic plans that are really just IT project Gantt charts. I mean, it's just what they're going to upgrade next.
Yeah.
It's not really a strategic plan at all, right?
Mm-hmm.
So your plan wants to tell a story. You want your strategic plan to outline what your business challenges are, what your vision is, and what that looks like at the end. And then you can fill in generally how you're going to get there.
Mm-hmm.
And what your general milestones are, and then project plans come later, right?
Yeah.
But you want to get that plan together and figure out where you want to get to, and then you can break it down, and like you said, like your experience, come up with all these other cool ideas that you can get to as you go.
Yeah, and I think that's probably the good and the bad of this year. We had our 2020 goals. We had the things that we wanted to achieve, to your point. Like, these are the big goals. Now, how are we going to work our way there? And those don't exist anymore.
Yeah.
As much as I want to achieve them, they're completely irrelevant because of everything that we have been through. And so it's been interesting to pivot and really take this time during the pandemic and look at, like, what are the different problems that we're experiencing right now, and how do we solve these new problems and create new solutions for things that we didn't even know existed. And so it's been fascinating, just from my perspective, to see things that I thought we did well, that given normal circumstances, we did. Absolutely. Great.
Yeah.
The policies and procedures did exactly what they're supposed to do. But we flipped that script just enough that now they're outdated and obsolete, and they are a detriment to the success of our organization. And being okay with saying, you know what, we can't do things this way anymore. Otherwise, we are going to work ourselves out of business, not in like 6 years, but like in 6 months. And it's such a quick turnaround. So
yeah.
That's the beauty in this chaos that we're in, of being able to see all of those new things and really capture it and then to launch yourself forward. And for us, it's been things like switching over to Microsoft Teams and being able to use that as an actual platforming resource the way it's intended versus trying to scan something in and then shoot it to the other person, or the way people are using Slack. It has completely revolutionized the way that they're communicating. And we're back in the office today for the first time with a majority, I would say about 80% of our team is back in the office. And it's been really interesting to watch people have face-to-face interactions, because now we've gotten used to this.
Yeah.
And going back to, oh, I have to stay 6 feet away from you. Oh, I need to have different conversations about how you're comfortable with our personal space.
Yeah.
And because I don't have to worry about that on here, I can just talk to you and we can be face to face and it's no big deal.
So
watching these different dynamics play out.
It's going to be interesting to see if people use Teams like when they're right next door to the person in the office.
Absolutely.
It will happen. Funny story, this morning, every morning we have a 9 o'clock Zoom call. And so we tried to have one this morning, and it was a disaster. We had like 5 or 6 people out of the office, and so I still wanted them to be included. But we didn't want to all go into one large conference room together, because we're trying to distance, but not really. And so then listening to everybody's Zoom calls like down the hall, it doesn't work.
You can actually now define that. Go, okay, this is the good at work.
Right.
Yeah.
But I love that we have that tool at the ready.
Yeah.
Okay, let's deploy this. It's ready.
Yeah. Well, that, I mean, I'm biased, of course, but that's where being, having a digital halo, right,
mm-hmm.
makes you much more agile. Because you're agile, you can react to things like this and whatever the next thing is, right, that's happening. The other thing, too, on strategic plans, I'm not a believer in creating a strategic plan and then putting it on the shelf for 6 months, right?
Right.
Build into the plan itself, you should revisit it every month, at least revisit it, and adjust and change. And don't be afraid to really break it apart and it may look completely different throughout the year than it was when you started. But business change, climate, you know, changes, you know, you don't know. So you think strategic plan and like a 2-year strategic plan, well, that's fine to have that kind of vision. But it should really be evaluated every single month. You should go through it as a team and say, okay, what do we need to change? What's working? What isn't? What are we going to kick out? And don't be afraid to let go of it.
Mm-hmm. Dan, I'm so glad you said that, because, again, something the three of us have been talking about is exactly that while we are now well into the pandemic, it's not new anymore. There's not a whole lot of surprises that are happening daily, right? Mm-hmm. Still very much in it, and none of us that I know of still has a crystal ball or a Harry Potter wand that works, and so you have to plan for the unknown still. And so we've all been talking about what I've been kind of calling the long game. So looking now that we're in the summer and halfway through the year at what your holiday season may look like.
Mm-hmm.
So are you restaurants? How does your seasonality in the fourth quarter of this year potentially look different? Well, we don't know all the right and real answers to that, right? But we have to think about that and plan for that. And part of the strategic plan really has to include in the short term, typically talking about migrating folks back into the office. There's tech to think about. There's some HR things to think about. There's HIPAA things with HR to think about, depending on how you might be screening your staff. So let's go down those types of lines for a minute, whether it's an office or remote, but essentially those things that we have to now include in strategic plans that we didn't have to consider in years before.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a great point, Alison. And one of my first phone calls this morning was to our IT folks to say, hey, we're headed back into the office, and I anticipate we're going to have some IT needs today as people are getting their equipment squared away because they had it all set up at home. And now they're bringing it back in. So what is that going to do to our servers and just recognition of firewalls and things like that? So, I don't know why I didn't think about it until this morning, because I knew we were coming back to the office. But it was on my drive in, I thought, oh no, today's not our folks' IT day. Like, they're only with us on Wednesday afternoon. So I need them to be accessible if we have something come up and everybody's computers won't do what they're supposed to do. And so that's now part of our checklist if we have a second or a third wave, or if, you know, one of the things that we were getting ready to do is test going remote anyway because we were going into tornado season. So this is built into now our remote office kind of working for whatever reason that is. And that's not just like an event, whether it's pandemic or weather. It's, you know, what if we have somebody on the team who needs to work remotely because of a sick parent or sick child or just life event. Now we have something in place for them to be able to do that. And so we're looking forward to what does that mean in the long term. But, you know, some of the other things that we've really started thinking about is, like if you are a retail space or a restaurant space and you are typically hiring throughout the fall season, ramping up towards the holiday season, are people going to be available? Are you going to hire as many people? Are you going to, you know, move your services to more of that curbside service when we have a high kind of infection season where people are often, you know, more sick? Is that going to change your business model? And those are all things that people, I think, need to be aware of and think about and really think through their benchmarks. Like, what's our cutoff point? Like, if this happens, then what happens next? And that's one of the things that I think we did well with the pandemic. And as we were transitioning out of the office, like, okay, if we lose like this many businesses as accredited businesses financially, what does that mean for us staffing-wise? What does that mean for us in productivity? Like, what are the expectations that go with that?
Yeah. And I, you know, taking your IT support, so you outsource your IT support.
Mm-hmm.
So one of the things, and just a what if, right? You might say, okay, based on this, for our outsourced IT, we need to build into the contract somehow greater backfill capability or shorter response time intervals. And there may be a greater cost to that. Maybe but can they do it? Can they provide that? How much more does it cost?
Mm-hmm.
What's that look like? If I have to pick up the phone, how am I prioritized to your other customers? Right. And you really can take that and think strategically, and what's a better way to make that service work for us? We need the IT outsourced service, right? But there are issues we have with that. So what does it need to be going forward, given what I know now?
Mm-hmm.
Really start to break that down and figure out, you know, your MSA or whatever kind of agreement or contract you have, what do we need to build into that to meet our new needs going forward? And just and that can all go into it.
Yeah,
exactly. And Kit, talking about seasonal hiring, you know, even before we get into quote-unquote seasonal in the short term, as so many companies have some level of remote and in-office or in-person, what have you, work, you know, evaluating how onboarding looks different. So maybe reevaluate those checklists. And Dan, we had talked about electronic signing of documents and things like that. So let's get some things to consider there, because again, that's another thing, onboarding, that needs to be looked at and evaluated differently in a strategic plan for a growth path in our current landscape.
Yeah, that's a really good point. And so I talked earlier about how our HR files are all paper. What's ironic about it is all of the forms for them to fill out are electronic. So they start electronic, and then we move to paper, which now thinking about it seems crazy that we've done that to ourselves, because it's the tail wagging the dog. It's not the other way around as it should be. So we have kind of that first step in place of all the paperwork we need, but how do we put it in a format in a way in which that person can sign everything electronically and do that well and make it accessible? And that's where the technology, I think, for me has been really hard, because not everybody has to say, like, let's say we sent somebody their employee ahead of time and said, okay, here's all of your forms we need you to fill out, and these three you're going to have to DocuSign using this software, and these two you perhaps need, like, an electronic pen or something to be able to use. And or you could just use like your mouse and cursor on your machine. But knowing what that person has could very well be a limitation to their availability to work within our system. And so once they get on board and we give them equipment and all that kind of stuff, like, yeah, it can work itself out. But how do we put the right things in place so that it's not equipment dependent, I guess is my question.
Yeah, and it's so critical that you not run out and say, hey, let's buy a document management system. That should not ever be in a business strategic plan.
Mm-hmm.
Like, your business goal is to better automate, or not even that, right? Enhance that paper flow process, right? In some way, right? You can get people onboarded faster. You can get more accurate data. You can track data. Now, whatever those business things are that you want to have happen, right?
Mm-hmm.
Then it's up to the IT, technology, digital, whatever professional to figure out the right automation, the right level of automation in order to meet those business requirements, right? But it's easy, especially for leaders, to get in this thing that I want that digital widget, right? I want that
thing, right?
Right?
Yeah.
You got to get out of it. You got to look strictly at the business. And it might not always be a purely digital solution. It could be a hybrid solution of some sort, right? And also, don't feel bad about paper-based. I think last I read, about 60% of all processes are still paper-based. So,
yeah.
You know, something that's still heavy on the paper. The other thing you have to consider is the legality, right? Electronic signatures,
mm-hmm.
even cutting and pasting is signature in the signature line is now being accepted in courts as a signature, right? It's the commitment to sign that is what it is, more than the physical signing of it.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a lot of misconceptions about digital signatures that
mm-hmm.
are old ways of thinking now, and that you don't have to think that way today. So having someone that's really up on that technology and the legalities of it is really important. But that shouldn't be your job. I know, Kitt, you're talking the other day about, was it editing a PDF or something? And you're like,
yes, I get so far in the weeds, and I want to be a doer, and I'm just not.
You should not be a doer.
And I get trapped by the things I want done because I just want it done now, and so I'll just dig in and do it.
Yeah.
And I make more of a mess, and a couple years ago, I made a promise to my team. I said, I will stop pushing buttons. Because what happens is I'll get into, like, one of our proprietary softwares to BBB, and for us it's called Interactive Blue, and I'll get in Blue and I'll start pulling reports. I'm like, oh, I can just fix this really quickly. And so I'll pull out the SOP, and I'll start, like, going through and, like, fixing stuff, and I don't know what I'm doing, and I create a bigger mess. Not obviously with bad intentions, but then somebody has to come back and clean it up after me. So I have promised I will stop pushing buttons. And this year is, I'm just going to embrace that I'm not a doer and be okay with that. And let the person who is the expert and really has in mind for what it is that I want done, like, just let them run with it, because that's their strengths. And so why wouldn't I put that in their wheelhouse and let them just have at it?
Yeah.
Oh, sorry, Dan, go ahead.
Go ahead.
I was going to say, Kitt, yes, maybe, but you are so great at disaster relief planning, is what I'm trying to
say.
In a moment, I really want to talk about, you know, as people start to go back into the office, what are some of the things they should think about? And you know, let's give them permission, as we've all kind of been talking, to set their own rules and things, because so many companies are still trying to figure out how to do that. That is, in fact, a strength of yours.
Thank you. I'll talk about that here in just a second. Dan, what were you going to say?
No, I was just going to say that I admire you for taking on the technology and trying to figure it out. But, and I am guilty of some of the same things, but, you know, I have a new respect, or I've always had a big respect for, you know, I've tried to fix plumbing. But,
mm-hmm.
you know, getting a plumber in and do the work, like, or whether it's playing tile or whatever it is, whole new respect.
Right.
I'm trying to do it myself. And then seeing someone that's done it over and over again for a long time. So I definitely appreciate that, and that's important to keep in mind.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Because people who have that expertise can do it so beautifully. Mm-hmm. And while I can probably get through it, it's not going to be the 100% that they can bring to the table. So I'm a big believer in knowing what your strengths are and digging into them and really shining in that expertise. And the things that are your weakness, you know, you could probably get it, like, this much better.
Yeah.
But my strengths, if I work on them, I can get them like this much better, and I can really have exponential impact.
Yeah.
So.
And a lot of times, if people are having to fiddle with the technology a lot, not quite doing, and spend a lot of time, a lot of times you got to look at the process, right? Is it automated in the right way? Is it systematic of other issues?
Right.
And we kind of need to break down the whole thing and, okay, is this really producing what we wanted to produce, right,
yeah,
in a timely fashion? Or am I spending more time on the automated side than I was doing manually, you know, in the first place?
Absolutely.
So, yeah. We got to look at it, go, okay, that's the system. You know,
for sure. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so, Alison, getting back to your comment and question, thank you for that. I do love disaster planning. It's something that, unfortunately, I guess, I have a lot of experience in. And so it is one of my strengths. And I think it's a neat just kind of endeavor because it always looks different. There are some components that are always the same, but sometimes it can have a different flair or spin to it, and depending upon what's going on. And so taking that experience and then looking at how we transitioned out of the office and transitioned into the office, you know, for me, I know the biggest key to it and the success of it has to do with communication. And it was overkill, I think, on some days, but necessary. We had a staff meeting every single day at 9 o'clock, and some days were longer than others, but it was just a way for our office to stay connected. And as things were unfolding, having that open channel of communication so that people knew what to expect, or even being able to stay connected with one another so I know what your face looks like. And we're still continuing to build and grow that relationship. So that was a huge part of it. And understanding that people need grace and flexibility as we are making these changes. And Dan, you said it earlier, you know, what is it, 63% of the population does not like change?
That's right.
We have just been through some of the most humongous change we will probably see in our lifetime.
Yeah.
Yeah. Absolutely. 2020 is not over. But if you are so averse to change, considering the majority of our population is, then people need grace and flexibility in how they navigate that change. And that's one of the things that we've worked really hard at, is just letting people work at their own pace as they're transitioning back into the office and not making it a hard, like, we're all in, everybody has to be here, you have to be here at this time. It's exactly like it was on February 1st is what we're going to June 1st, because that's not – I don't even have the right word for it. Like, people just can't adapt to that, because not only do we have a lot of unknowns within our own office of what's going to be safe and what's going to be okay, but as a world, like, we don't know what that looks like. So to have the expectation that people are going to be okay with just showing up and pretending like nothing happened is irresponsible, quite frankly, and it's not fair. So we want people to be successful in their jobs, and we want them to feel safe and secure and however they're able to show up. And so, like, I've got one person who, you know, isn't going to be here at all this week because they just don't feel ready, and that's okay. And then another person's like, I've got kiddos, things happening. And for me, you know, I have to leave at 3 now because the kiddo things are different. And so giving each other that grace and flexibility, I think, is a tremendous opportunity to strengthen the culture of your workplace. And just having that dialogue of, I'm okay not wearing a mask, or I'm okay wearing a mask, what is your expectation? And being open and communicating about that and what that looks like. But also, like, for us, we have meeting space in our building, and we're not open to the public right now. So we are very slowly phasing other people back into our lives and into our building. And so that was very intentional in how we do that, so that we can be thoughtful in what we want to be able to tell them as they're coming in, so they know what those expectations are.
Yeah, intentional, that's a great word, right? And, you know, we're talking about planning, and you can plan for intent, and the critical part of that is that you talk about how your business model will change, or it's changing, or it needs to change.
Yeah.
It's business, right? You can still look at it as part of your business model. So your open parks, right, so the way you open up to the public for use, your use areas, right, how you do that is going to be different. It's just a different business model than before. And how's that changed? How does that fit in? So it can still be, there can still be rigor behind that, right?
Mm-hmm.
And defining how that works, just like you would any business service or product or whatever. How does it work? How are we going to communicate that? What do we need to do to make it meet the needs of our clientele? All those things, like with any business model, you can work that in, and it should be. And the intentional part of it, I think, is you hit it right on the head, right? And thinking that out. And really, oh yeah, well, just come in and, you know, stay 6 feet away. Yeah, well, that may be, you know, it's got to be a little more than that, right? So, how do they come in? And hand sanitizer and distancing and technology, you know, that all should be worked out.
Yeah, absolutely. Mm-hmm. Well, and even coming up with, I love checklists, so even coming up with, like, what's our protocol for how we're going to do this? And everybody understands the steps. And so we, one of our other VVB offices came up with a really thorough checklist, which was great, and we modified. But in having that conversation with our team, people weren't necessarily looking for rules. They just wanted to know, like, what's available. And I think that's important too, so that we can respect each other's boundaries, and it's not a hard line in the sand. If you don't want to wear a mask in our office, it's okay. But if you do want to wear a mask, it's also okay.
Yeah.
Because we want to respect the boundaries of both of those individuals and what they are experiencing in their life. And they can stand as far away from each other as they want to. They can't get within a certain amount of feet of each other because that's part of what we're doing, but you know, you don't have to be right up next to somebody without a mask on if you don't want to be. And it seems silly to have those conversations, but the reality is we have to have the conversations because if we don't, people don't know.
Yep.
And the uncertainty of it just creates a level of anxiety that we have too much anxiety in all the other areas of our life because there's so much up in the air. But this is the area we don't need to add extra.
Yeah.
Agreed.
Go ahead, Alison.
No, Dan, please.
Yeah, so I think that in communicating that on a consistent basis, right, through your internal, whatever social media you use internally, and also I think it's important for leaders to communicate that outside of the organization. You know,
right.
This is what we're doing for our internal, you know, and that just helps spread the word. But, again, you can build that into how you do business. So every week, I'm going to post on our internal whatever, reminding people, hey, great job so far. You know, remember, it's 6 feet and it's masks are good if you want. Not required, you know. Just you know, messaging going, right? And
absolutely.
In this day and age, there's no reason, nothing in the way of communicating in a consistent space. You know, yeah, communication tools available for you.
Right, indeed.
Meetings. To do that, right? It didn't have to be an email, right? Lots of different ways to do that.
Mm-hmm. Well, video is a great way. Kitt, you said this earlier. We've all gotten so good at this kind of communication here, right? And so let's, as we start to wrap up here today and kind of do a quick recap of possible tools, if you will, that people might consider looking to, whether by brand or not, let's talk about some video things. So, Dan, if you were going to put that message out to all staff or maybe your customers and the public, what are some ways in which somebody could share that information via video?
Yeah, and I tell you what, we talked about this last week, I think.
We did.
Video. Oh, my God, it's crazy. People have been talking about this for a while, right? The video is going to be the new thing, right? It's the way, initial way to communicate, and it's going to be the first thing people look for is video. And they're going to choose watching video, 30 seconds. Right, or so, over reading a paragraph, right, reading an email, right, it's going to be tough. Well, it has just been pushed way up there. Because now, I remember before, people were like, video conference, okay, I'll figure out camera, but now it's like every day. I mean, no one that I've seen has any issues doing a video conference. So video is top of mind right now. So I would say, first look at video as your first entry point, right? Your first thing. You're going to try video first, right? Our common thing is to think of email, then a blog post, and then a text or whatever. But think in terms of video. A 30-second video spot, you can just shoot and then you can post that. And now every service provider allows you to post video. Whether it's YouTube, LinkedIn, Facebook, whatever, you can post a video. You can embed it in text. You can do it everywhere. So think about doing that 30-second video. Doesn't have to be anything fancy. That was your first way of communicating. If you don't formalize it, then I would then have in that video an ability to have some chat response. If you're going to do it live, give the people a chance to respond, not having to be on the video necessarily, but they can chat you a message or some sort of remark or comment either after the fact. So if it's recorded, then I can leave a comment, a question, or whatever. So you can make it interactive. Even though you're recording it, it doesn't have to be a one-way piece of communication.
And Kitt, you've mastered the, I consider a mastery, after so much practice and a little coaching, the 1 minute, what I call organic video. To Dan's point, it's not fancy. It's not overly produced. It's shot with a cell phone or an iPad or, you know, a smaller, less formal device. So talk about that for a minute and how that could be effective in addition to what Dan just shared.
Yeah, absolutely. So I do a lot of videos for CBB. I do a lot of news videos. It would be a better way where somebody puts the camera in my face and I talk. And that I am extremely comfortable with. I've done it for the past 7 years, and I've done it at other jobs before BBB. And then something about producing it myself and having to use that little dot that is on my computer and my own camera on my computer to make a video, it was my kryptonite. I was not prepared for how difficult that was going to be. I thought, oh, I do videos all the time. This is going to be so easy. And my problem was that once I would start talking on the video, I would watch myself talk, and then I would think, why am I making that face? Why does my mouth touch that way? And then I kept, like, exaggerating it and making it worse. So I have learned I have to make myself really small so I know where I am and I can see that I'm, like, in the frame and that I'm positioned correctly, but I can't see all the facial features that I'm making. Or I will talk to the dot that's on my computer screen. It felt a lot more natural to have that conversation with somebody else or just staring at something else like I was talking into a camera versus watching myself do it. So that was kind of the first thing that I learned. Secondly, I learned I just need a lot of takes, and once my muscle memory gets in the groove, it'll get a lot better, and I'll feel more conversational, which is my style in that. Because I was condensing it down, we couldn't edit necessarily because we were trying to do them a lot quicker, and I wanted something that was just truly 1 minute or 30 seconds. I tried to write out a script, which, if you know me, is 100% not my style. It is awful. And so I tried writing a script, and then I got a teleprompter app on my computer, and so it was rolling, and I was reading and trying to not make these crazy facial features. And so then I literally had like 100 takes one day. It was like hours I spent in front of my stupid computer trying to make this work. And so I was like, okay, I'm ditching that. And then my mom calls, and she's like, what are you doing? I was like, I'm trying to make these videos. And she's like, it talked to you like 3 hours ago, and you're still doing it. I don't think I made one. So I did some of that, and then by that time, the light had completely changed in my bedroom where I do all of my videos, obviously not today, and so I had to take a break because I didn't have the same lighting that I had before. So then I talked to a friend, and she gave me her ring light, and so now I have lighting whenever I want it, so that's been a huge bonus. And I would say the biggest thing for me was just getting comfortable with doing something that I knew how to do well differently.
Yeah.
And what were the things that I needed to be okay looking at, not looking at, and realizing, yeah, it's organic, and it's going to look different, and it's not going to look professional or produced. And I don't necessarily mind that. I just didn't want for people to view that video and be like, oh, this lady is not got it together. Like, she doesn't know what's going on or how to do this well. And for them to be thinking about that versus what I was talking about. And then as I got more comfortable, everything else relaxed. and so my facial features weren't quite as crazy, and the little tics that I had that I didn't realize slowed down and weren't quite so off the wall. But it just, it took time, honestly, more than anything else. I was really comfortable with it, and just try out different things then. And so maybe if I sit like this, or maybe if I'm standing up, or maybe if my computer height is at these different levels, like, what does all of that look like? And doing a lot of testing and retesting and just spending time with it. And what I'm excited about is the fact that now all of that testing and retesting is done. You know, the spot I did for the promo today, I did in one take, and it truly was 30 seconds, and I was so excited. And it was my personality. It came through the way I wanted it to. It doesn't look overly produced, I hope. And I was able to put something together that I'm proud of. But that does show the personality of our organization, because that's one of the areas in which I feel like our BBB is really successful is, you know, we're here in Oklahoma City. We are part of the Oklahoma landscape. If you have something and you need to talk to somebody, we are real individuals who can help you with that. And we care deeply about what BBB does and is for our community. And I want that to be conveyed in our videos. And if it's overproduced, it doesn't always come across as sincerely as our organic videos. And so it's been really fun to see the evolution of this whole thing firsthand.
So thoughts I would add to round out the video conversation here from a marketing standpoint, but however you choose to use your videos, remember that if you're using them on social media, nearly all of the social platforms require that they are a minute or less. Instagram. So keep that in mind. So, you know, minute to 2 minute tops. But again, I love what you all have shared about using video in a variety of ways in which to communicate with folks right now. So let's do a quick recap of some tools and things for people to think about. Let's kind of do a linear recap in terms of our thoughts and ideas for a checklist. So if you're looking at things to outsource, automate, or eliminate, you might look at a virtual assistant for phone. You might look at chatbots for internal or external communication, depending on your preference and your business setup. You might look at, if you're not already using a communication tool like Slack, which is kind of like my favorite AOL instant messenger from way back in the day, the modern version of that. But some other tools that you guys want to mention that maybe we haven't, that folks might consider to help them along in this landscape, because as we've talked in all of our Now How series, you know, we recognize that folks may have had to let go of vendors or furlough or let go of staff. And so we've got business owners and senior leadership folks that are juggling a lot of hats, bats, and balls right now. So some other tools that might help them out that they might look into.
Yeah, I would, on the video is top of mind for me right now, I would think about using YouTube as a good platform. You don't necessarily have to post on YouTube. You can store videos on YouTube. So you can create a video. It's a great repository to put all your videos up there. If you want to venture a little bit more, you can do channels, of course, right? Create your own channel on YouTube to display your videos and have that as another touch point for your customers. And I think YouTube Live is going to be a growing thing right now. So with this, what we're doing today, it doesn't necessarily have to be in a video conferencing session, right? Because I know we're talking about it's pretty much one way to a group of audience. YouTube Live is an up-and-coming platform for that. Band will actually do broadcasts. They can later record and distribute. So I'd look at that. Also, your customer relationship management or CRM tool is a great place to look for automating processes, data analytics, automating document management, right? A lot of CRM tools. And yeah, Salesforce, a lot of people use that, but it's really expensive and complicated. There are a lot of free CRM tools out there to get you started. But it can be a great aggregation point, a great starting point for a lot of the like more complicated automation and document management stuff we've been talking about. There's a lot of it's already built into that, those tools.
Yeah, and the only thing I'll really add to that is more from a strategic planning perspective, and that this year we used SOAR, so that strengths, opportunities, aspirations, and results. And I would say while we typically do a 3 to 5 year strategic plan, this is a great opportunity to break that down and to think, okay, 1 month, 3 months, 6 months, what are the things we can get done, which I think is such a great way to do it annually and see what are the small things that may have big impact whenever you stack them all together, and bite-sized chunks, making sure that you are being productive in a way that does get you to those results, and using what you were talking about earlier, Alison, just that eliminate, outsource, and model of what's our roadblock? Like, what's the thing that when I'm working on my computer or I'm at home or now I'm transitioning back to work, like, what's the frustration and how do we solve it instead of just dealing with the frustration? You know, there's a better solution for it. So use your team wisely to help you think through that solution and how can we do this better and how can we be of more service or better service to our vendors or to our customers and whatever that looks like.
Yeah, and I would keep that, if you think of digital, I would keep the focus on the business solution. What do you want the business piece to look like? And then you, along with someone else, can figure out what the digital best tool is to make that happen. But keep that business focus in mind. And then a strategic plan, yeah, regardless, review it every 30 days, right? Mm-hmm. And you can lengthen that out if you need to, but get in the habit of reviewing that on a very close periodic basis. Right? Make it dynamic and agile.
Kit, Dan, as always, such great thoughts, great ideas, great tips, great resources. You guys are a plethora of knowledge, and I know that this information will be really helpful to folks as we continue to all navigate things together. So thank you so much for your time and information. And folks, if you have thoughts or questions, please don't hesitate to reach out to Dan at Personifi Solutions. You can find him on LinkedIn primarily, and you're welcome to reach out to us on social media at CDB Central OK with any thoughts, questions, and we're happy to share that checklist heading back into the office that Kit mentioned earlier with you if you should reach out via social. So thank you again, both of you. I appreciate you and your information.
Well, thank you. Enjoyed it.